I'm here in the beautiful hills of Los Gatos, overlooking San Jose and the whole South Bay of San Francisco area. And I'm with Tom Quinn, who is the CEO and founder of a company called eFuel Corporation. And Tom, you are standing in front of something that looks like a gas pump, but what actually is it?
Well, this is called the microfueler. Its main purpose is to make ethanol. It makes 100% ethanol that you can put into your car. The two areas, a way you make ethanol with this machine is to put in either sugar or discarded alcohol into the back of this machine. And you use the panel up here, press a button, and within days of fermenting the sugar, it turns it into ethanol. And you can pick up the hose, and it has a 50-foot hose on it, and you can drag it over to your car from the side of the yard if you want, and fill your car up with ethanol.
So, but the difference is that this actually is going to reside at your home or at your office.
That's correct. It's completely made to operate at the home. In the United States, you can get a permit free of charge from the federal government to produce under 10,000 gallons per year of ethanol for your home use, or if you have a business and a property that you want to make it for your vehicles and stuff like that. So this is what it's made for. It's a consumerized version. Makes it very simple. There's three things you hook up to it: power, water in, and water out. And that's all. It's kind of like just like a washing machine.
So let's start from the beginning. Tell me, if you will, tell us, how did this come to you? Why did you want to get involved with this? Because this isn't your normal line of business, let's call it.
Well, I've been an entrepreneur. I've come up with some exciting products in the past that people have used and had excitement of using the product. So a couple years ago, I saw this paradigm shift occurring in the fuel market where the instability, or what we call oil peaking, where which is the danger signs when Saudi Arabia and the United Kingdom and Mexico are reporting that their oil fields are producing less than they did a few years ago. So that sparked my interest as an entrepreneur that innovation has to jump in quickly. And so what fascinated me and gave me the direction to move in was Henry Ford. 1908, Henry Ford created the Model T Ford. He based it on ethanol. He was a big advocate for people using ethanol because, one, anybody can make their own ethanol back in 1908. They had been making it for thousands of years. And that oil can only be made by industry and not by people. And it wasn't an unlimited supply that you could get of oil. And granted, back then, he only knew that there was a reserve in Pennsylvania. He had no idea there was a reserve in the Middle East and what have you. But his position was clear. Someday, we're going to run out. Now, in 1916, people kept migrating towards gasoline and not ethanol. And his cars were made to run either on, like, flex fuel, on either ethanol or gasoline. He told the New York Times in 1916, I'm very concerned with every barrel of oil we're now consuming. Someday will have to be replaced by a barrel of alcohol. And just a few years later, in 1920, Congress amended the Constitution and started the alcohol prohibition, which completely wiped out any production of alcohol, distribution, or consumption of it. And that lasted for 13 years until 1933. And by 1933, when we ended that, oil is well in place. Standard Oil had their gas stations throughout the United States at every major city. And it was a very convenient product for us all, and we've never looked back. No one ever looked back.
So prohibition had the dual bad thing of causing perhaps organized crime to get organized, or crime to get really organized, and perhaps putting out of business people who would have been used to creating their own fuel for their vehicles, and sort of spurred on this whole thing of the big oil companies.
Yeah, I believe so. I mean, it certainly had a factor. And I mean, whether you believe in the conspiracy or not, I think it is a very interesting point that we, right when the automobile was taking off, we took alcohol off the market, which is essentially ethanol. When you look at ethanol as a product, it's very superior to gasoline. It's a much better product. It has 120 to up to 129 octane, and the octane is the most valuable ingredient in a combustion engine to, you know, give it fuel efficiency for power and what have you. Gasoline is often touted that, hey, it's got more BTUs, but that really has to do with the energy of heat. When you run an ethanol car, it's very interesting. You can actually put on 100% ethanol, put your hands on the manifold during when the engine's running, and not burn your hands. But if you do that with gasoline, it'll just sear your fingers off or your hands off, which shows that that's why we have large radiators in cars, because it's actually trying to dispense of all that heat that they call as their energy. In reality, ethanol is a better product. Indy runs it on all their race cars. The world record for speed on an automobile was broken last year by a Dodge Viper running on ethanol. So ethanol is just a better fuel for people. You can mix it with gasoline easily. You just take what we make or you make out of this unit itself. If you have a quarter tank or half tank of gas in your car, you just fill the rest up with eFuel 100 ethanol into it and drive away. You'll notice that the performance is great. The U.S. Energy Department reports that cars not made for running on ethanol, that they tested, and you'll find this on our website at eFuel100.com, is that they run just fine with 65% blend of ethanol and regular gasoline. If you want to break your dependency on gasoline altogether, you can get a converter that'll allow the fuel mixture of your car to increase more to ethanol side, and then you can eliminate the gas station visits altogether.
If you do that to a new car, does that void the warranty?
Well, what we've noticed, you know, a manufacturer of a car is going to really look at their parts and workmanship on the car. I mean, you're already running ethanol in your car right now. The law requires that 5 to 10% of ethanol be running your car, so you're already using ethanol whether you know it or not.
But how does that affect the warranty of a new car?
We haven't seen anything that affects the warranty by using ethanol.
You wouldn't go in for a tune-up and the mechanics are going to get freaked out because it's not gasoline.
I haven't heard of it, and there's such a push for us to go to the alternative fuel. I think the automobile manufacturers, I think, are, you know, bending over backwards to make sure their cars are compatible with ethanol, because they know ethanol has been in our fuel supply now for a few years already, since we got rid of the NTBE and we replaced it with ethanol. So that we're already driving with ethanol. It's just a question of how much more do you want to put into your car.
Tom, tell us how somebody acquires one of these. How does somebody get to own one of these, and what is the process that they have to go through in order to make their own ethanol?
Well, first of all, the microfueler is available online at the eFuel100.com, or you can go to microfueler.com and get it there. There's a lot of educational video on there that allows them to see how it works and how it operates with your car and what have you, how to adapt your car better to run full ethanol on it. So I really encourage people to go to the website and look it over. And then when you're ready, you can purchase it online. It's only available online, and we'll allow people to purchase this thing anywhere in the world. We'll ship it anywhere in the world, pretty much, that allow a product like this to come into their country and stuff like that, but certainly in the United States. There are discounts from the federal government that give you 30% off for all businesses that purchase this. You can have any business entity you want, but you get 30% off, $1,000 for individual that want to purchase this. And even states have an additional, in some of the states, another 20% off. So depending where you live, you can get 50% off of the cost of this thing, which is just under $10,000.
Okay. Now, and when you say that there are state federal and state refunds or credits, does that come right off the top of what you would owe on your tax, or is that part of what you take that down off your income?
Well, that's something to consult with your tax person, but basically, yes, it just comes off whatever you pay on taxes. It reduces as a tax credit. Yeah, exactly.
Okay. So, Tom, what is the return on investment time on this? Somebody buys it, they spend the money. How long do you think it would take for someone to recoup the expense?
Well, in the energy market in general, it's one of the best values that's out there, beyond even solar. It's 18 months for a return of your product, and that was actually based on $3.69 a gallon, and I think gas has gone up higher than that. So, you have to recalculate it as the fuel prices go up, but it's just going to get better. And sugar would normally be purchased through a company like Cisco. We're establishing a network with Cisco to deliver the sugar. And I wanted to mention, too, that we can use regular table sugar with this product, or what we call raw dry crystal sugar in it, but you'll be able to buy special ethanol sugar. Now, for those who haven't read about it, the U.S. Farm Bill had just been passed, and so they're going to be able to acquire sugar for a lot less, and as you know, as some of the articles indicate, about 2 cents per pound under the new Farm Bill for ethanol purchases. And we as a company will set that up with companies like Cisco, so a consumer just has to get on the phone, call up and say, I want this product delivered, or they can go to the warehouse and pick it up themselves if they want to save money on the transportation cost, because that's really the cost of sugar, is the transportation of it. So, but it's a great news for the people in the United States to get a hold of very low cost sugar that will allow them to make ethanol for under a dollar a gallon.
Okay. Now, does it break a patent or a secret if I ask you what the person then does next? I mean, they take this bag of sugar, perhaps, mm-hmm. and they mix it with water mm-hmm. in the unit. Is that just what happens?
Well, it works just like a wash machine. You open the hatch up in the back of this unit, and you just pour the sugar in, close the hatch, the hatch locks. We measure that sugar. Which has, by the way, has ethanol yeast mixed in with it. And we immediately start filling it with water. And once it fills with water, it's run through a conditional temperature cycle to maintain a certain temperature, because the temperature of yeast mixing with sugar actually starts to rise. You know, it's the natural science of making ethanol. And we maintain that temperature with special sensors and stuff like that inside the system. And then within a few days, you've got alcohol, which is ethanol, that you made. And the machine then will report how many gallons of ethanol you have. And depending what system you have, you'll either have 35 or 75 gallons of ethanol ready for you, depending on the level that you want.
Oh, it can make that much in one... process?
One process, which lasts about a week, will make about 35, and there'll be others that make, you know, 70 and more than that, depending what your needs are. A typical family, we figure with 35 gallons a week is just fine for a car of two or three cars. The normal two-car family runs about 13.5 gallons per week, but, you know, I mean, that could be exceeded if you have long travel, and California in particular, where we're standing, everybody seems to drive a long distance. But anyway, that's kind of it is. If you have a small fleet of cars and you're running a business, you may want a larger unit. You can also run discarded liquor. I would encourage everybody, you know, before you even buy sugar, is one of the videos on our website shows you that we have a local community here. It's not very big, Los Gatos community. One restaurant alone was discarding 6,000 gallons of alcohol. It was a microbrewery restaurant where they made their own beer. But when you make beer and wine and stuff like that, there's a tremendous amount of loss from creating that. So that has a percentage of ethanol in it. And by putting it into a machine, we will extract the water out of that beer, wine, or spirit drink, and within hours, you're going to have ethanol that you can put in your car. Now, if you watch the video, this restaurant was pumping it out so fast that we had to stop it. I mean, it was just like we're getting 60 gallons per day from these guys very, very fast. And so, you know, if you look at the whole town in general, it was about 50,000 to 60,000 gallons of discarded alcohol. So take larger towns and large scatters, then, you know, there should be no reason why people should be buying sugar until they eat up that. Or a soft drink company discards a tremendous amount of sugar water, and you can recover that as well. And all this stuff is going on the drain now, and you can, you know, we've had a lot of call from state representatives that are very interested now in trying to improve the laws to allow people to recover from these restaurants and allow them to profit from the recovering of this discarded material, because who wants that down the drain anyway? It's, you know, it's not healthy for the environment to have alcohol and sugar water being dumped on our sewage system anyway. So the fact that we can recover it and make, you know, fuel out of it is just fantastic.
Yeah. Well, and it would seem like for bottling companies, again, soft drink companies, things like that, that this would be a good thing for them, obviously, to fuel their own vehicles. Their trucks may work on something other than gasoline, but certainly the private vehicles of the personnel that work at a brewery or a bottling company would benefit from that.
You bet. Ethanol is so, and the more you get involved in educating about ethanol, the better it gets. We learned also is that you can convert diesels to run on ethanol, a diesel engine. So you mentioned the trucking industry, which is hit very hard right now because diesel's going for a higher price than gasoline, and these guys are suffering. We get a lot of calls from them, and countries like Brazil and other countries around the world, they're already running their diesels on ethanol. And you can Google that and find an information, or you know, write us and we'll send you what we have about it. But there are conversion kits right now that you can convert your diesel into an ethanol running engine and avoid the high expense of diesel fuel. Okay.
Now, with that in mind, how does the exhaust from ethanol, how does that affect the air? How is that compared to gasoline?
Excellent question. Well, gasoline in general produces about 19 pounds of carbon for every gallon we burn. Ethanol also produces carbon dioxide when it's burned and used. Not as much as gasoline, but the major win on ethanol is it's a plant food. So when you're running on ethanol, you're actually reducing carbon in the air by about 85%. And the reason why they say 85% is you have to harvest the plant, and you have to transport the like sugar to places, and that's going to require oil currently right now. So if you look at by the time then you put it in your car and you burn it, what's happening is as you burn that and the carbon dioxide comes out of your car, the regrowth of these plants are going to absorb the carbon dioxide back. All right. So in theory, if you were if you cultivated and transported your sugar not using oil-based product, you'd get 100% back as it was recycled through the plant life. Which anybody that wants to see an example of the result of that is to go back on the old videos of Brazil. Brazil was known for a very polluted environment. It was bad. I mean, I've talked to people that have actually gotten skin diseases over the years from the pollution that they had in there. And now it's completely turned around with their use of ethanol. They use more ethanol in their country than any other country in the world. And it's just been a remarkable turnaround in the quality of air that people have experienced over there.
Okay. Now, let's go back to the homeowner who's going to have one of these in their garage or backyard. What are the safety issues, or if any, that they have to be concerned about?
Well, one of the things the federal government requires is you cannot use this inside a structure home that you live in, for obvious reasons. You can't use a power generator or a barbecue grill inside a structure you live in, and the same goes for this. Now, one of the real good safety things that we did with this thing is normal ethanol is made with a fire combustion system. It's like your stove. They'll heat the water up to extreme temperatures to boil and separate the water from the alcohol. We've eliminated that by using what they call a nano membrane system. A nano membrane system actually, we send the diluted alcohol with water through the membrane and a vapor, and you can see this online how it works, and the actual filter, which it is, it's a membrane, separates the water molecules from the ethanol molecules without going into, like I said, a combustion fire system, which makes a sim system a very safe system to make alcohol. Very, very safe. And the other thing I'll point out is that, people are producing whiskey and tequila in some areas as high as 160 to 180 proof. Well, that's somewhere between 80-90% ethanol. It's we're already being able to go out and buy that stuff, and in many cases people are drinking this stuff, So the fact that we're putting it in our cars now shouldn't be an alarm to anybody. We're already handling alcohol in many products. It's in our paint thinners and stuff that we use and chemicals like that. I mean, it's a cleansing product. In fact, one of the benefits by using ethanol in your car, another one is the fact it cleans out the oil deposits in your car. It's a very good cleaning agent. Some people say, well, my wife stopped by the gas station, accidentally filled up with 85%, this E85, which is 85% ethanol, and the car is running a little rough. Well, in some cases what's happening is your car is getting a shock cleaning all at once because it's been running 5 years on oil. So it's just an amazing fuel that I think I really would like other people to get educated about. Once they see how wonderful a fuel this thing is, they're going to be willing to adapt to it much faster.
Now, if a person had this in their home, can they share it with their neighbors? Is there any kind of prohibition against having a club of people who might have their own, have microfuelers, and so when you travel around the state or the country, you'd stop at somebody and get fueled up from them?
Sure. A lot of people have talked about that and discussed that. Certainly that's going to be a popular thing. You'll be very popular to have one of these in your neighborhood. The only thing that's on your permit is that it's not for sale. It's for personal production. So be it. You can take it from there.
If you do this, we've been talking about sugars, using sugars and yeast. What about plant grass cuttings? Can you do anything with that?
Well, this gets into the controversy of corn. Corn is a starch, and the reason why it's had so much scrutiny is because you have to take the natural way to make ethanol is only with sugar. So you can take corn and break that corn starch down into a sugar, then make ethanol. But that takes oil and energy and chemicals to do that, to break it down. And that's why you've heard a lot of controversy, like this corn ethanol sometimes isn't any good. But so if you take a switchgrass, which is cellulosic, which is the fiber of plant material, they're working on it right in our Bay Area here. UC Berkeley has got a huge grant to research and study that. They're making some good progress on that. So, yeah, I mean, all plants, if they're broken down into sugar, can be used to make ethanol in this machine.
But you'd have to break it down, and you couldn't simply take grass cuttings. I mentioned this because I noticed I have this giant garbage can in my backyard filled with my lawn clippings, but I can't just take that, dump it in.
Yeah, the way you do that, which is a very dangerous way, and it's very energy intensive. They intensify and they cook this thing. They cook it to gasify it, and those are normally 10,000 degrees or higher. And you may hear that, but it's not as simple as people may think. So it's not just like put the grass in like Back to the Future and it turns it into ethanol. You're going to have to go through a very high intensive process, and that's going to take gas or gasoline or oil or coal to get temperatures that high to gasify that lawn clippings.
Right, but I guess with the sugar being as inexpensive as you were indicating, even if it wasn't exactly 2 cents a pound, that's little money.
Sugar is the most plentiful product on the planet. I joke sometimes by saying you're never further than 50 feet from sugar. If you think about it, you go to the office, you go home, you go to the restaurant, you can't go anywhere where there isn't a pack of sugar somewhere. And the United States consumes about 3.8 million metric tons of sugar per year. An example, Brazil produced 500 million metric tons of sugar. So we don't, there's no mother in the United States saying my kids aren't getting enough sugar. And I think we produce less sugar now than we did 25 years ago. So for people to say that we're stealing from the food supply is really ridiculous. The other thing to mention is that look at all the prices of our commodity food stocks are going up. Corn's gone up, threefold, and rice, wheat, all that stuff has been going up. But then look at sugar. Sugar hasn't gone anywhere, if anything. It's gone down. So I think it's the perfect feedstock, sort of say, in the classification there, for ethanol. And that's why I believe the U.S. Congress overwhelmingly passed the Farm Bill that included the access to low-cost sugar for ethanol production. It is the solution, and the only solution I can see. All this other stuff we're talking, you hear about on the news, is high risk. Switchgrass, as you mentioned, that's high risk. It's not there yet. It's currently at $20 a gallon, for converting that. And hopefully we're not going to get to $20 a gallon for fuel.
But well, at least not until the end of the summer. Now, Tom, this unit is a demo unit. It's not an actual production model. So is this the same size? Is this the same configuration that somebody would get when they're buying an actual production unit?
It will look the same, but it's going to shrink down about 35-40% from what you see right now. It'll be very convenient to put in the back of a pickup and may even fit in some of your vans and stuff to transport it. So that's the good news. This is our alpha unit, which we've got five of them out there. We've been testing. It's running great. We actually produced it right here. I can fill up your car before you leave. But it's really solid right now, so we're moving very fast. Our delivery starts in the fourth quarter of this year, a few months from now. We'll start to deliver our product, so We're ready to go. We made this announcement May 8th, and we're overwhelmed with sales and excited dealers that want to become dealers to sell the product themselves. So, yeah, visit our website, learn about it, and if you want to get a reserve one, go online and reserve it, sure.
Cool. And when are you expecting to start deliveries?
Fourth quarter of this year.
Fourth quarter, okay. And what do you expect to be able to do in terms of production numbers?
Well, we'll be in the thousands. There's no reason why this is a consumer product. You know, we're used to, I come from the consumer electronics field, so we'll have the sub-assembly done in China, and then we'll have the final assembly done in California, and we'll also have a plant over in the UK, and we'll do one in Brazil as well. So there's no problem here. There's nothing in this device right here. We have heavy patents on what we've done, but there's nothing that's rare that we can't, you know, produce tens of thousands per month of.
Okay. And in terms of funding for the company and the company's ability to be able to carry on and meet what you're hoping to do, is the company well funded and structured?
No problem. I've funded it myself personally. I've been down this path many times before, and we are having a round of investment right now. A lot of people do want to get in on the investment, so we're going to let a few number of people in as an investor on the company, but we're looking good there. With the order base we're getting in now, it's not a problem. We're, you know, for a company just announcing its product and getting immediate recognition and revenue, it's probably been the fastest company growth I've ever seen.
Now, can you talk about numbers in terms of orders so far, or is that something that you'd rather
not really talk about, other than the fact that, you know, you're going to be into the thousands?
Good. Well, Tom, I'm looking forward. Tom is going to top off my gas tank with ethanol, and it'll be interesting when I get back to Sacramento after my drive. I'll do a little addendum to this to let you know that I made it home, safely, and so that'll be good. And so, Tom, thank you very much, and good luck, and we look forward to seeing perhaps a lot of these around and hearing
so.
A lot
we
more.
We hope so. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so we're going to try to fill it. We're not going to try. We're going to fill.
We're going to put some ethanol in.
And what I think is particularly great about the 50-foot hoses, that means you could forget which side of the car your gas tank is on, and you could still reach it, like the old days.
Right. Well, it's like I visualize like a garden hose. You can drag your garden hose out of the backyard and hit a plant where you need to hit it, and then put the hose back. Same thing here. 50 feet is a long hose.
Yeah, that's a good. It's a good thing.
You ready to go?
Yep. You can't drink this, of course, right?
No.
It's not drinkable. Okay. Great. All right. So I will be driving home, and I'll do a little pickup video when I get there. Tom, thanks again.
Appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, obviously I made it home safe and sound. Did the car perform better? Who knows? It certainly didn't perform any worse. It performed just as well as the drive going to Los Gatos. So certainly having the ethanol, the 100% ethanol in the vehicle was not a hindrance. So I have no complaint about it. What I was thinking is that Is this something that's for everybody? How good is this device? How good is this idea? Well, as you'll come to learn, and perhaps as you heard in the interview, and as if you'll read more about this product, you'll find out that in order to create the entire 35 gallons at one time of ethanol, you have to use, almost 500 pounds of sugar. Now, that sounds like a lot, And of course it is, especially if you're elderly or you have some kind of a handicap and it's hard for you to be lifting that amount of sugar and pouring it into the device and all that. But that aside, you can buy the sugar in bags that are manageable. And if you are the kind of person that I am, for example, I like grinding my own coffee. I'm not sure that my coffee tastes any better than instant coffee that I might buy, but I enjoy the process. And so I think I could I think I could do the 500 pounds in manageable size bags of sugar. And it's obvious, I mean, obviously this isn't something that would be good if you have an apartment or if you're living in a tent somewhere, although maybe a tent isn't so bad, but an apartment certainly wouldn't be any good because you obviously have to have a place to store all the equipment and the device itself and then the ingredients. But, you know, there's a lot of people around that are really handy guys that are the kind of pickup truck guys that could easily handle this. And there's a lot of families that have teenage boys that are, you know, certainly could use an extra way to help earn some allowance money. And I think that if you could be making your own fuel and saving the kind of money that this could allow you to save, I think that's a pretty good way for somebody to earn some allowance. The other thing is that I think what's so exciting about it is that it gives you great freedom. I mean, that you could be creating your own fuel in a device like this that allows you to thumb your nose at all those thieves in Arabia or that nut down in Venezuela, where you don't have to, we have to be listening to him and thinking about buying oil from him. I think this is a heck of a device, and if you can do it and save that kind of money, I think it's great. So I hope you learned something from this. I hope you picked up something, and please visit the website, the company's website, and check it out and get some more information. And why don't you write to us? Let us know what you think, and if you'll have the opportunity to buy one of the microfuelers, please let us know what you think and how you're doing. Thanks for watching.